is what the folk is still around. What the folk? What the folk? For the radio you crave at your last hope. What the folk? What the folk? The stations change the formats, we don't fix what isn't broke. So for radio that's timeless, just tune into What the Folk. What the Folk? What the Folk? What the Folk? What the Folk? So relax and settle back, tune out the world, don't have a stroke. Cause if life's about the journey, why not ride with What the Folk? What the Folk? What the Folk? What the Folk?
And welcome to What the Folk. And this is Mark. It's the second Tuesday of the month, so it's time for our show. We got a special one for you today. The program tonight centers on one of the significant psychologists in the country and former president of American Psychological Association, Dr. Nadine Kaslow. And our program is hosted by myself and Dr. Betsy Gard. I am in awe of both these women for their accomplishments in mental health and for what they are doing now. Betsy and I will be helping interview Nadine, and I will be providing music that has a mental health and psychology theme, and most of the music inspired by Dr. Kaslow's career. I'm just going to do a little bit of a test here and welcome you both, and we just want to hear if your microphones. And Nadine, I'm going to veer off the folk music track because I had to play this song tonight as the first song of my set. So let's get to some music here. He's not a folk singer, Chuck Berry, Nadine. And our special guest this evening is Dr. Nadine Kaslow. And Also here tonight is another psychologist that I admire quite a bit, Dr. Jane Yates. She is a leader in Atlanta for psychoanalysis, and tonight the videographer for the program for YouTube, where we hope to post the show probably tomorrow, if everything comes out okay. If I try and review all the accomplishments of these women at the beginning of the program, we will never get to any more of the program and the heart of the show, which is to learn more about Dr. Nadine Kaslow, in her own words, of course, with a few questions from the peanut gallery here. Dr. Nadine Kaslow is an American psychologist, the 2014 president of American Psychological Association. That's the National Association of Psychology. And she is the editor of the Journal of Family Psychology. Before her current affiliation with Emory University, Dr. Kaslow worked at Yale University. She was the recipient of the 2004 American Psychological Association Award for Distinguished Contributions to Education and Training in Psychology. She is a professor and vice chair for faculty development in the Emory University School of Medicine of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences, also in private practice at the Emory Clinic. And she's the chief psychologist for Grady Health System and is the psychologist for the Atlanta Ballet. That's a wide continuum there. She's also board certified through the American Board of Professional Psychology and Clinical Psychology, a clinical child and adolescent psychology, and couple and family psychology. So those are all board certifications that she has. She is the former editor of the Journal of Family Psychologists. One of Dr. Kaslow's key accomplishments was founding the NIA project. The program began in the early 1990s and has impacted the lives of over 2,000 women. The Grady NIA project is a program in suicide and domestic violence prevention for African American women. The program aims to empower women to access the behavioral health services, find a new sense of purpose, and lead more meaningful lives, and affirm their commitment to living a violence-free life. The NIA project now falls under the larger rubric of the Atlanta Trauma Alliance, which Dr. Kaslow also directs. And Dr. Betsy Gard, believe me, this is a summary. This is not the full thing. And Dr. Betsy Gard is at the Atlanta Area Family Psychiatry Clinic. She's been adjunct professor at Emory University Departments of Psychology and Psychiatry since 1982. Since 2015, Betsy has been a clinical consultant at the International Rescue Committee Program and the Red Cross National Disaster Mental Health Training Team. She has been involved with disaster preparedness and has done volunteer work after floods, hurricanes, Ebola, shootings, bombings, and many other horrendous events. She has been a responder to people's misery, going to the center of disasters for many years, and has been on this show a few times too, and I'm hoping she will have a show on WRFG at some point in the near future. That is my hope. I think it would be wonderful if you did that. Well,
I have a question for Dr. Kaslow.
Well, why don't you ask Dr. Kaslow a question?
So, Dr. Kaslow, you have worked in an urban setting and helped to patients from the NIA program, and they have a great deal of emotional disadvantages, historical disadvantages, financial and social. So what are your thoughts in terms of what implications this has for the development of both mental illness and mental health, the disadvantages in these women's lives and others?
So I definitely think that having social disadvantages like problems with poverty or homelessness or not a lot of food can in many ways lead people to feel anxious and depressed and have a range of mental health symptoms. On the other hand, what has been remarkable to me is the incredible resilience that so many of these women show in the face of all of this adversity. And so, while on the one hand it can be very stressful and lead to the development of mental health symptoms, on the other hand, many, many people find adaptive ways to cope, to manage the stress, and really support one another and actually do quite well.
What do you see for those who are able to do that? What do you think are some of the key characteristics that help them be able to make those shifts?
So I think for many people, it's really having strong social support, whether that's family, whether that's friends, but really a strong network. A lot of people who care about them, who take care of them, and they take care of in return. So it's very mutual. And I honestly think that is true for all of us. I also think for many of these women, it's a sense of spirituality or religious involvement that really is incredibly helpful to them. And then really a sense of finding their own voice, finding a way to feel strong and powerful.
We have lots more to talk about with Dr. Kaslow and Dr. Gard here this evening, but we're going to get to some music. And tonight's program on What the Folk is looking at the career and accomplishments of Dr. Nadine Kaslow. And I hope you stay with us. We have music, more talk, an interview, and let's get to the music right now.
Public Affairs Bulletin Board. Acclaimed lesbian poet, writer, professor, and anti-racist, anti-imperialist activist, Minnie Bruce Pratt, will discuss queer socialism, sexuality, and gender on Saturday, March 14th at Karis Books & More at 7:30 p.m. Her political writings and poetry can be found in numerous books, magazines, and journals. She is a managing editor of Workers' World Mundo Obrero, the weekly newspaper of Workers' World Party. Minnie Bruce is the widow of author and activist Leslie Feinberg. The bookstore is located across from Agnes Scott College at 184 South Candler Street, Decatur, 30030. It is fully accessible and there is ample parking behind the building. This program is hosted by Karis Books, Karis Circle, and co-sponsored by Workers' World Party Atlanta Branch. For additional information, 404-524-0304 or atlantawwp@gmail.com.
And you're listening to What the Folk tonight, and we have all kinds of good music, an interview tonight with Dr. Kaslow, so I hope you stay tuned. If you're in your car, terrific. We'll give you some interesting things to listen to all the way around, so stay with us. I want to let you know that we are doing our fun drive this evening, but it doesn't look like I'll be able to answer the phone tonight because we got a lot of moving parts in the show, but the best way you can donate to WRFG is to go on WRFG.org, and we have a secure site where you can make a donation. And the area that if you want to focus on this time slot, it's Peach State Festival. It will not have my name or the name of the show. Doesn't matter. Your donation is what matters. So if you could donate some money to the station. We're hoping to raise some money. And we do this about two or three times a year. I think three times a year. And it means a lot to us. Mainly it keeps us on the air. We don't have any advertisers. We don't have any corporate sponsors. We go by asking for people who don't have a lot of money to give us money. Kind of like Bernie's campaign, I guess. But still, if you like the shows that are on here, this one and other ones, go online. WRFG.org and make a pledge. You go to the button that says donate and then move through the menu there. You can put your credit card in there. Peach State Festival is the name of this time slot, and we'll be happy to receive your money, and you probably will get a tax deduction for it, so everyone benefits. So thank you so much. And our guest tonight, Dr. Kaslow, and I might ask a question. You know, I've been around long enough to know that your mom was quite a powerhouse in psychology as well, and I'm wondering how her career affected yours.
Sure. Well, I was really quite fortunate. My mother went to graduate school when I was in elementary school, and she graduated when I was in sixth grade.
Wow.
So I really had, at a time way before most women had, a wonderful, wonderful role model for women being successful professionals. She was really the only woman in her graduate program at that time, and she really was a trailblazer in many ways, both nationally and internationally, in terms of psychology. So I think there are countless ways in which that influenced me. One was to have a sense that it was important to have both a personal life and a professional life and to be a successful professional woman. My father was an incredible support and very engaged and involved in those ways. Some people say occupation is a sex-linked gene in my family. My father was a financial planner, so was my brother. My mother and I are both psychologists. So my mother certainly, I saw how much she loved her career and still does today. She remains quite active. She certainly, I think apples don't fall far from trees, and we have similar interests in many ways. And we've really found a way to become very supportive and encouraging of each other, both as mother and daughter and as professionals. But I think the main thing was I saw how much she loved being a psychologist, and that was very influential.
And among other things that you do, you also see patients, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, how do you approach patients doing so many other things? How do you even have the time to do that? And what's your experience in terms of seeing clients for mental health problems?
So I really like doing that a lot, and I do that in two very different ways. So part of what I do is see people in long-term psychotherapy, typically through Emory Healthcare, and then I also see patients at Grady Hospital, both psychiatric inpatients and women through the NEA Project. When I think about doing psychotherapy, what's most important to me is the therapeutic relationship. I think that there's all sorts of different kinds of therapists, many very valuable ways to approach psychotherapy, but in my mind, and I think the research shows this, that what really matters is the therapeutic relationship. How the patient or client and therapist get along, how well they can communicate with each other, how much there's sort of a sense of simpatico and that they're working together towards similar goals. So in my mind, that's one of the most important things. And then I guess the other thing that I would really add is that I don't just see psychotherapy as helping people not have symptoms anymore. I think that's part of it. But for me, it's really supporting people in flourishing in their lives, in having a really good quality of life, and in finding their own sense of meaning in life and pursuing that, whatever that might be.
Very important qualities to have for a therapist. We're going to go to some music now. The music is going to be a little bit on the silly side about psychotherapy. So, but I think we do have to have a sense of humor in these things that we do. And everyone in this room is a psychologist. So if there's a mental health emergency here at WRFG, we are well prepared. So let's get to some music.
Therapist will probably get along.
program is focused on the career of Dr. Nadine Kaslow, a psychologist here in Atlanta and former president of the American Psychological Association. And Betsy, I understand you have some questions.
Well, you spoke about your mother as well as you are a leader and have been a leader in many, many different areas and ways. Do you think that women leaders have different challenges than men as leaders? And do you have any suggestions to young women who are working to succeed in leadership roles?
Well, I think all leaders have challenges, and so there are ways in which women leaders and men leaders have sort of similar kinds of challenges. Leadership is not easy, although it can be very rewarding and meaningful. But I do think that women leaders are often facing different challenges than men. For example, one time somebody came up to me right after I was elected president of the American Psychological Association and told me they questioned if I could be president because I was so short. I'm not even 5 feet tall. And I think there was some sense of that, of like I didn't look the part. And I think women are more likely to encounter things like that. I think sometimes people think women are too soft to be leaders. They're too emotional. They're too sensitive. And so women can hear that. And on the other hand, quite frankly, if women are tough and they're assertive, they get called words that aren't very nice, some of which begin with the letter B. And so I think that women either get one extreme or the other extreme and have a hard time many times being viewed as competent and effective, but also as compassionate and nurturing and supportive.
You've written about courageous leadership. What does courageous leadership mean in your life?
So, in many ways, I think a good leader is primarily one who's collaborative, works well with people, engages everybody, wants diverse voices at the table, really values them, collaborates with people and partners with them, and that they also are transformative. They have a vision and they want to help the team move forward. But sometimes there are issues that emerge when one's a leader that have to do with big challenges, difficult situations like we're facing right now with coronavirus, for example. Major kinds of challenges or integrity concerns where one has to step forward and say the hard things, make the difficult calls, and really have the fortitude, the courage to say things that might not be popular, when we might not be the status quo, that they go against the status quo often. When we think about some of the leaders we admire the most, certainly, you know, in this city, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., he had tremendous courage and was inspirational in that courage. But much of that was because he talked a different way. He wanted things done a different way. And he was willing to buck the way things had always been done and had the courage and the fortitude and the power to inspire a whole nation to shift how it functions. And I really think that it takes courage to do that.